more touched by token human rights violations. One of the oldest countries in the world, where civilization grew for a long time, and some say that humanity came out of that little patch. I consider Ethiopians as benefactors of Muslims, because when Muslims' rights were violated in Mecca, Ethiopia was the place where a just ruler was sitting there, and we, the earliest Muslims, were given refuge in there. So this is the history, that when you have just rulers, then obviously you need to glorify them for their justice and human right acceptance of them. So I have a deep sympathy for all those Ethiopians who have narrated their stories today, and I wish that their country is as just as it was in the days of my Prophet, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we need to, as I said, we need to teach others by our own examples, and that is something we need to carry on with our children, with our friends, show tolerance and be a model of that society, of that people whom you want to see others as. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, very much. To speak about the purpose of the meeting, Kefala Almo is a member of Tribal Solidarity Executive Committee, originally from Ethiopia. He speaks about human rights of all of the people. Let's welcome him.
Good evening. Human rights are universal and fundamental freedoms of entitlement, which are inherent to all human beings. The purpose of today's meeting is to demonstrate the significance of working together with different people who have been experiencing or witnessing violations in their respective countries, and to create solidarity between the very victims of the people of different countries. In spite of the recognition of the United Nations Human Rights Declaration, many dictators like the ethnic-based tyrant in Ethiopia, the ethno-sectarian quota system in Iraq, the authoritarian regime in the Sudan, and other repressive regimes around the world ignore human rights and commit crimes against humanity in different forms with impunity. Today, more people are being killed by dictators than by conventional wars and natural disasters. Ethnic, religion, territory, corruption, and interest-based attitudes are the main causes of human rights suffering that will continue to lead us to the current as well as the future international community to a serious disaster, i.e., we cannot meet the need of the present as well as the future generations internationally without defending human rights inclusively. It is the responsibility of the current and future generations to ensure the fundamental rights and the well-being of mankind, to sustain the inspiring science and technology progress of our wonderfully developing and integrating world. We believe that human rights should be given the highest priority as global warming, terrorism, and environmental degradation. Using their divisive policies and corruption as a tool to suppress, marginalize, and polarize certain parts of society. This in turn produces misery and anger, which ends up in genocide and destruction of habitats and services around the world. Corrupt and criminal regimes support each other to extend their unlawful activities inside and outside their controlled land. They also harm each other by arming and harboring the rebels of their neighboring countries. It is also distressing that the ethnic-based junta in Ethiopia has continued its shocking crimes by systematically changing its appearance and by changing new fake changes. We have been witnessing that the regime in Ethiopia have been releasing and imprisoning few dissidents again and again for its gain propaganda. Furthermore, the regime has been kidnapping and harassing even British and other European citizens in collaboration with other lawless countries. Modes, codes, and types of human rights violations vary from country to country, but all of them end up in the violation of the universal and fundamental freedom of entitlement by committing arbitrary killings, tortures, displacement, marginalization, segregation, imprisonment, intimidation, and harassment of innocent people, including the elderly, women, and children. That is why we strongly believe that individuals or group of people from the victimized countries must work together with international community, third world solidarity, human rights organizations, and responsible governments to discourage such unholy and inhuman alliance between dictators of different countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jafari. I think
the violation of the human rights have also taken place in the Kurdistan region, as witnessed, as we witnessed recently, when the demonstration in several towns protested against corruption and deteriorating buildings and international human rights organizations such as Human Rights Board reported to them on this issue. As we approach a new general election in Iraq, the common belief and concern among Iraqis is that, again, it could not be fair for a new election. Those primarily corrupt party will once more drop Iraq into their rights as they seek to protect their dominance using vast network of corrupt corruption. Despite this, these big challenges, democratic forces will contest the election on May 12th. It is also important to point out the popular protest movement, which we are part of, a big part of it, which began in July 2015, is continuing every Friday in Baghdad and at the Arab Square, and several other protests. Unfortunately, none of the British media outlet covered such a thing. Mr. Speaker, dear colleagues, what I have just said is only the tip of an iceberg, only a glimpse of a long list of challenges facing Iraq now. We, in the Iraqi Democratic Movement, firmly believe that the main source of such calamities is the disgrace and shameful the ethno-sectarian border system. The only way to protect civil and human rights in Iraq must be through a peaceful change that is the establishment of a real democratic, modern, and civil state in Iraq, which will uphold and protect the human rights, a state where Iraqi are all equal citizens regardless of their religion, ethnicity, gender, or militants.
Thank you very much, Professor Abdullah.
Sudan human rights report continue to be defined by government attack on civilians in three zones. the three war zones, repression, violation of basic civil political rights, including torture, rape, restriction of religion, freedom, and disregard for obligation on civilian protection and the international humanitarian law. In all three war zones, the government is still obstructing access to humanitarian assistance, access to rural health areas. The Nuba Mountain and Brunei is completely blocked. An ethnic cleansing campaign against people of Jebel Mara by the rebel support forces is ongoing since January. Rebel support forces and other government-aligned militias attack civilians on daily basis. After it is genocidal campaign in Darfur, the government now is using it as tool of repression for all parts of Sudan. Sudan has failed to hold those accountable for serious crime committed during the conflict in Darfur, South Sudan, and Brunei, or for other serious human rights violations. A term of torture in Sudan. Sudan signed the Convention Against Torture in 1968, but more than 30 years later, it is yet to ratify the convention despite repeated commitment to do so. Torture, rape, and extrajudicial killing remain widely practiced in Sudan, often on a daily basis. During the last 3 months, hundreds were arrested and detained solely for peacefully exercising their right to freedom of expression and peaceful assembly. Many of those released reported that they had been subjected to torture or ill treatment while in detention. President Omar al-Bashir is wanted by the International Criminal Court for crime against humanity, war crime, and genocide, with the issuance of two ICC arrest warrants in 2009 and 2010, and Bashir became the first ever sitting head of state to be wanted by International Criminal Court. This was also the first genocide charge ever brought by the International Criminal Court. Since then, several ICC member states have since hosted Bashir, contrary to their obligation to arrest ICC fugitives. The UN Security Council has been referred the situation to the ICC, has consistently failed to ensure Bashir arrest. National out of 175 countries, according to 2017 Corruption Perception Index reported by the Transparency International, the head of state and government is believed to have embezzled up to $9 billion from oil revenues. On freedom of religion, the International Constitution of Sudan provided for freedom of religion, creed, and right to worship, assemble, and maintain places of worship. Some laws and government practices are based on government interpretation of Sharia system of jurisprudence and don't provide protection for religious minorities, including minority of Muslim groups. It's well documented that there were reports of authorities detaining Muslims, including an imam, and arresting, intimidating, and detaining Christian clergy and church members on religious grounds, denying permit for the construction of churches, closing, demolishing existing churches and church schools. More than 25 churches in Khartoum State were demolished just in 1 year, in 2015, that they were not given permission from the relevant authorities. Our recommendation for the UK government and for the international community that we call for rethinking of the EU support to Khartoum process and Khartoum regime, consider sanctioning human rights abuses and corrupt individuals in the government under the Criminal Finance Act, and strong action and the restoration of Islam. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Can I invite Sandra Settley to speak on human rights in Ethiopia?
Thank you very much. I'm quite delighted to have been on. I have a few comments on Ethiopia, and it's all self-explanatory. So, firstly, in January this year, as most of you, I suppose, will have seen in the news, Donald Trump referred to, quote, nations in Africa as shithole countries. Although I hesitate to quote the President of the United States, who the former FBI Director James Comey has just described as a liar and a man of weak morals. With regard to Africa, it is the case that Ethiopia today is an African country with an appalling record of human rights violations. Shitty, therefore, may be apt in this context, if you will pardon my syntax. Or so, the country's record of arbitrary detention, torture, and extrajudicial killing of so-called political dissidents continues largely unabated. Whatever the relationship with the US, Ethiopia is very much these days on the global economic stage, with, for instance, China investing heavily in the country. According to one Chinese newspaper, private Chinese investment reached $269 million last year. And according to John Hopkins University in the United States, since 2000, China has loaned Ethiopia $12.3 billion. Statistics from UNICEF in research undertaken between 2005 and 2016. For under five-year-old child mortality rates, Ethiopia ranks number 35, just below the Yemen and Tanzania. To put this into context, the highest ranking countries include Luxembourg and Iceland at 192, so that's 35 for Ethiopia. While macroeconomic indicators place Ethiopia on the road to economic improvement, this is far from the whole story. Ongoing human rights violations, for example. For those here tonight who are less familiar with what's happening on the ground in Ethiopia with regard to human rights abuses, and I would advise having a look at reports that have been written by Amnesty International and also Human Rights Watch. And nearly in conclusion, that Prime Minister Halit Mariam Desalegn unexpectedly resigned in February this year after 5 years in power might have been good news to some. But unexpectedly, the next day after his resignation, the government declared a national state of emergency. Again, seemingly contradiction. Now in place is new Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed. Mr. Abiy has said that his government, quote, is ready to open honest and constructive dialogue with the opposition. But under his watch, the national state of emergency remains in place, as I've understood. On the matter of constructive dialogue and hopefully an improvement in Ethiopia's appalling record of human rights violations, in my opinion, and to conclude, until proved otherwise, the record on human rights in Ethiopia, regarding the record on human rights violations in Ethiopia, the jury remains out. Thank you.
I just wanted to take one point that Ms. Sattler raised about Ethiopia. Thank you for all that. She praised economic growth and the double duty of economic growth that the Ethiopian government has been taught for the last 7 years. the World Bank has been talking about the Ethiopian damages. IMF has been talking about the Ethiopian economic growth. The Ethiopian government says 12%, World Bank says no, it's 11, IMF says no, it's 10. But they all talk about economic growth. They are focusing on economic output. They don't talk about the economic growth. Ethiopia now owns $123 billion in loan. See, this is excluding what the British government and the American government have been pumping into that country for the last 25 years. So if you look at what goes into the economy, and if it is carrying $123 billion of debt, which is going to be a liability for the coming, I don't know how many generations. And this Ethiopian government, I've lived under three governments. I've lived under Haile Selassie, I've lived under Mengistu, and I've lived under this. They are the most corrupt. They are the most human rights violators. They are the worst of everything, really. And the minister, the statistics minister of the current government that came a couple of years ago and reporting about population growth, she said, oh, we lost 2.5 million people. How can we lose 2.5 million people? I mean, you know, but in Ethiopia, there have been so many experiments going within the country, in the population. It is an ethnic-driven politics, a little driven federation that we have got. It's very antagonistic.
In the argument on Ethiopia, it was about 9 years ago in 2009, was on corruption in Ethiopia. And there was a gentleman who traveled from Canada, and he proved that about 8 billion of that corruption has been taken out by then the Prime Minister, who started in 91. So yes, we have done meetings on even particularly on corruption. I agree with you. And Sandra will comment at the end, because I will allow the speakers to come back at the end instead of coming back on each question or comment. Now the next, I want to give the floor to another lady who is Secretary General of Pakistan People's Party of Women Wing in United Kingdom. I know there is a Councillor Mansoor Ali sitting from Bangladesh, there's Zameer who is sitting from Sri Lanka, who is very senior, from People's Party, from Muslim League, from all. So we are here as a United Nation of the world, and this room represents that. We are more representative than even Gorjum, where this meeting is happening of Commonwealth. Samia Ali.
At the scale of what's going on in all these countries. And not that I didn't know, I obviously didn't know, but how deep it is, you know, that was my reason to come here and find out. As the lady was there, she said, yes, you know, we're having a meeting, but what is the outcome? What are we going to do about it? I mean, speeches and all that's so fair enough, but I would like to have some kind of practical practice for us. You know, you tell us where we can be. You know, we can be helped. I mean, as Mr. Nishari Saab said, that the women are the most, you know, targeted human being for. I mean, there are actually, in some countries, the animals have got more rights than human have got rights in these third world countries. It's a shame we call it third world. It's only one world. Why there has to be third world? I hate this, you know, name third world. Where does it come from? It comes from corrupt politicians. And who has made them corrupt? Us, by voting them. We have to make sure that we vote people who are sincere, but obviously it's very hard to find out until they come in the government, and then we know they're not sincere. The thing is, As I was there in the Kashmir protest as well, and we're coming back on 18th again. There are too many atrocities to be, you know, to be told here. There's, you know, more than 10,000 women have been raped. That's a status we found from women. It might be, you know, double the might be 20,000-30,000 women, because we never get to find out the real scale of things. They just tell us the whatever is on the surface or whatever people find out. As we know, it's a digital, you know, era now we're going through, and the most darkest as well. The more we know, the more we have got power to resolve things, the more we can't. It's a shame that it's like we're living in dark ages. You know, I'm ashamed to be talking about this at this time and date, when people, it's like we're going back to, you know, thousands of years back. Maybe they were better than us. I'm sure they were, because there was no power-hungry politician on this earth. So,
because
so all I can say is the answer, in my, you know, small opinion, I mean, is unity. Let's get together.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. So, anybody? Yes.
From Sudan, and I know the details of what's happening in Sudan, and we could have through the state here for years talking about the human rights violations in Sudan, because I noticed that all the four speakers, four member countries, and the other commentators, the ladies who talk about Kashmir and others, they say sort of stereotype by behavior of violation of human rights in all those countries. For Sudan, al-Bashir, as mentioned our friend, al-Bashir is the most corrupt person, and his regime is the most corrupt regime, and the worst human violations in all the world. And they have been condemned by the Human Rights Commission so many times. But I think, as in view of what has been mentioned, I think this gives me the idea that we have to emphasize and concentrate on the solidarity. I think this necessitates that we work in solidarity and emphasize the importance of solidarity for us all. We have to be to work together, because we are suffering from the same enemy, or suffering from the same violations in all those countries and other countries in the world. So good military and dictatorial regime, or even civil dictatorial regime, are suffering from the same thing. So together, I think, as a solidarity organization, whether it's the third world or first world or whatever, we have to target the United Nations, in particular the Council of Human Rights, and as well as to address the British government, the UK government, because they are engaged, for example, engaged in Sudan. The British government, the UK engagement in Sudan, have got a very big problem in striking a balance between the interests of the UK and the protection of human rights and democracy in Sudan. So a solidarity group, I think we need to meet regularly and have a sort of more organized work under the president.
Thank you very much. But we will carry on working. Hashim, you wanted to say something.
Just a few words. Thank you very much, Mr. Thank you for organizing this meeting with colleagues Abdul Malik and Kifari. Just wanted to pay tribute to our colleagues and friends at the front line in these countries fighting for human rights and protecting human rights. And they don't attend meetings like these. They risk their lives, go to refugee camps, document human rights abuses, publish it, and we should all together, as we can see from the discussions, there are common threats corruption and abuses, human rights abuses go hand in hand, whether it's in Africa, in Sudan, Ethiopia, Iraq, Kashmir, everywhere. So we should put pressure on the international communities, our governments, to actually help NGOs and human rights activists in the countries. We're lucky today we have a colleague who has a first-hand experience in building capacity for human rights activists. Maybe you want to say a few words about the Al-Amal organization and their work in human rights activities. Thank you very much.
Yes, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Mustafa. I'm a member of the Iraqi Al-Amal Association, which was established in 1992, and has been active ever since in Iraq. Firstly in Kurdistan, and then in the whole of Iraq. Part of its activities is human rights, women issues, advocacy, training, and what have you. And although, as Hashim said, we do share a lot of the symptoms of human rights abuses everywhere in the developing countries, there are certain elements of individual issues and challenges in every country. And I think in Iraq, there are certain windows which can be actually used to challenge the human rights abuses. And there are examples. For instance, when four young people, when the demonstration started in Tahrir Square, they were arrested. The chairman, the present chairman of Iraq Al-Amal, challenged Al-Maliki face to face in public in a conference, and they were released. There were attempts to, for instance, change the family law in Iraq twice. The government tried, or members of the ruling elites tried to change it to make it supposedly Islamic, but in reality very reactionary, which would have allowed children to be girls of 9 years old to be married, and so on and so forth. Challenges like that actually succeeded in stopping them. Similarly with quota for women, and so on and so forth. I mean, the list is very long, and I can go on about it. But what I would say is that in order to achieve those in developing countries, in standing for human rights, requires, first of all, clear vision as to what we want. And second, proper action relevant to that country. Not every country is the same, and not every action should be the same. And thirdly, is a collective action. Individual action doesn't work, collective action. Challenging the government in 2010, Iraqi government in 2010, and took the Speaker of Parliament at that time to court for breaches of the constitution. Had the support of 800 NGOs in Iraq, and that's the success in reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I'm Hashim Abdullah Mukhtar from Sudan, from Darfur.
Thank you.
I would like to agree with you, with all the speakers who spoke about human rights. We know that there is the human right goes hand in hand with democracy. So we should all unite as to ascertain these states as to develop ways of democracy. The only way to develop democracy in third world, like my country in Sudan, we've been under dictatorship for the last 30 years, but we still hopeful that we will struggle. We will carry on doing the peaceful demonstration in the Sudan and out of the Sudan until we will be able to reach the point where we will topple al-Bashir, and then our brothers in Ethiopia will have some peace of mind. I am speaking from the ground that this these dictatorships has affected the whole world. We are speaking about Kashmir, speaking about Pakistan, speaking about Little Asia, Middle Asia, Africa. But listen, in Sudan, you would be killed if you spoke about any issue of corruption. Or in my place, I'm from Darfur, we have 200 displaced camps. And there was a genocide going on in 2003. The whole population, almost half of the population of Darfur, are now sitting in these displaced camps. What did the government, the Sudan government, do? They chopped all these non-governmental organizations, 13 of them, the major non-governmental ones, have been thrown out of Sudan and been left with no nothing. And the international community doesn't listen. They are very, very picky in responding. We don't want to take a fight against the international community. We will go with the flow, we will go with the way you have adapted that we all to have a solidarity so as to put a pressure on the UN and the other organizations. And would also encourage you, all these people who are here in the UK and in Europe, we have a space of democracy, we can go for demonstration. We should push these issues together. And if there's a demonstration for Sudan, people from Iraq should come and attend, because we need to make some kind of solidarity that it will depict a good picture of the whole nations of the world. They are asking for democracy. And thank you very much for this chance.
Thank you. And both are fortunately from Ethiopia, so you will be brief and not overlap each other. First, and then Aramis.
First of all, I would like to say thank you, I think, to the last speaker. It was very inspirational, maybe to hear your knowledge of history and antiquity. But also, we are in the UK, and many of us are UK citizens. How can we shame the misguided policy of, it is really shameful what we are seeing nowadays, this country had been great leaders, but what's happening now and all this intervention in the Middle East and in the whole world, the whole foreign policy is misguided. You started by saying, they are now looking into security rather than ethnic, ethical policies. So, as long as it suits this country's interests, they are just disregarding human rights. So they need to be shamed. And also we have to use, as you said, elections and other means really to maybe to change and really bring people who would listen to us. But kind of collective actions, I agree. We need to think about collective actions to relevant organizations, countries. And I mean, if we think along that line, under the circle of solidarity, how can collectively make more voice, our voice be heard? And be more effective in terms of influencing policy, especially the foreign policy in the UK is going down the drain as we can see.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
In actuality, in that same place, within the same government, within his own prime ministership, people were being tortured. Ladies were being naked in front of men, maybe 10, 15 men. Are interviewed after their release and being beaten up. Men are almost incarcerated. They couldn't even bear children. These kind of things are happening. And that person is telling us that they are closing that central intelligence agency. So please don't be misled by those informations and be aware. And the second point to mention is the UN. You're mentioning so many things. The UN, I call that organization an organization with a false teeth. Because that organization passes so many resolutions, but in the night time, I think they take out that false teeth and sleep. Nothing happens. So to tell you one fact, last year, in 2017, who, World Health Organization, employed part and parcel of Ethiopian government minister as the secretary of World Health Organization. Mm-hmm. What kind of UN do we have? So all of you have to be aware and We have to do something with it. Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, yes, Faisal Abdullah, to start with. And then I will conclude in conclusion.
Well, a couple of things. In response to the lady who raised so many questions, in fact, there is no shortage of human rights abuse in Iraq nowadays. And true, it makes our work is very difficult to trace every individual case and fellow to trace it. We are trying our best to exhaust all the venues, including the solidarity here and Russian people. And to give you an example, that the Iraqi government is not interested in the culture of human rights, they are not present here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sandra. You wanted to respond especially to a couple of points.
Yes, I mean, at some points that were raised, and the last gentleman there talking about lobbyists. In my research for my comments today, I came across a lot of that, where the Ethiopian government has put a lot of time in terms of websites. When you pull up something like UNICEF or the United Nations Development Program, you go right into the Ethiopian side of that, which has a lot of information that you have to, that you don't want. That you want, you want to look at the larger picture, which when you go to UNICEF main site, you can find. And so I encountered that. But to Mr. Alam, I mean, I say, I mean, I do apologize, because in no way was I praising the Ethiopian economy, not at all. Quite the opposite. In fact, like I could have prolonged my comments alongside. I was trying to make the point that you have a country whereby in some kind of economic indicators that are used on a global basis in macroeconomics, things have gotten better. But that does no good at all for most people. It's for the elite, the corrupt, their pockets are lined. And this is a huge problem. I mean, the displacement of people, I've made reference to that. It's a very sad and sorry situation. This country has had a similar problem insofar as Margaret Thatcher lowered taxes for the wealthy and talked about very vociferously the trickle-down effect that was supposed to take place. Certain economists from Cambridge and also people from France have commented on the trickle-down effect doesn't work. I came across in my research an Ethiopian who works for a United Nations body who used the word trickle-down. The elite are making money, foreign investments taking place, and there's going to be a trickle-down when everybody else, well, it, in Britain it's not worked. I mean, I despair to think it might work in Ethiopia. So, no, absolutely, it's the opposite of crazy. It's saying that if you have corruption, extrajudicial killings, detention of political opposition, and all the things that I named, and some economic growth, it ain't worth much. In fact, it needs to be challenged.
How to work together? I think we need to, like, we in the UK, we can work together because now there is a developed means of communications. So I think we need to use it, and we also need to engage our second generation. They are not working with us. We never talk to them. They have a very advanced skills, and they will really push our work, and they will. Our integration with them and with the UK community is very important for our work. And I think we need also at some point to form a coordination and like steering committee or whatsoever. When we come here, mm-hmm. we come for an action, to take action here. But during this time between the meeting, we should have something to do together. And solidarity is very important. When someone is talking about my country, and he is Ethiopian, and he's talking about Omar al-Bashir, the people who never turn to my meetings, they will listen that Ethiopians are taking care of our issues. So we need to help the Ethiopian to put their human rights in Sudan, and I'm sure the same will be, the same impact will happen if we talk about Ethiopia as Sudanese. It will unify the Ethiopians for the human rights. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. My task is to just conclude in 2 minutes, and first is to thank few people who have not spoken. They have attended the meeting and not spoken. I can't say everybody, but some of them should be taken and treated equally. Do you know that 31 countries of Commonwealth have less than 5 million population? Out of 53, 31 countries have less than 5 million population, small countries. If today or tomorrow the neighboring country who is very powerful wants to occupy them and one of them has only 200,000 population, they can go, my villager can go and occupy that country if they want to. So we have to respect smaller and larger countries, whether they are too powerful or too small. And that is the main issue, that we should have an ethical foreign policy, not only for United Kingdom, but we should strengthen United Nations. Because Secretary General of United Nations, day before yesterday, when he was speaking on Syria issue, he felt like a stooge, a prisoner. He couldn't speak out, as you said very rightly. We have to strengthen it. We have to support the leaders of the world who are trying to have ethical policy, and you and I can support them through our campaign and through our solidarity. Let's do it. Thank you very much for coming tonight.